How do you introduce someone who needs no introduction, who's an apostolic father, who has decades of experience, who runs in circles with Papa Bill Johnson and Heidi and Roland, Benny, and I could just keep going. How do you introduce someone that has impacted over 1 million Muslims to Jesus Christ? The truth is, though, Leif doesn't, he's not wired for me to talk about the things that he does. He cares, but he doesn't care if it does not come from a place of connection with the Father. 5 years ago, Leif came to this church that I was on staff at, and he preached the message of the orphan spirit. And it not only rocked me, it rocked an entire church. And since then, we've been on a 5-year journey of what does it look like to truly sit at the King's table, to be true sons and true daughters, and to not go after healings and then look around to see if anyone notices that God's using us because we're trying to be more important than we really are. Leif is an apostolic father. He's a father to me, my wife. He's a covering for me, but the truth is he's a son. He's a son of Papa. And this morning, I'm just telling you, you need to be prepared to hear from a son who's very close to the Father. If I'm gonna build a house, I want someone to build my house that has experience in building homes. If I'm gonna listen to a message on identity, I wanna listen to a son, not someone who's read someone else's book on sonship. And so I want to give a Bridgeway welcome to my friend and a father to me and this house. Let's honor Leif Hetland this morning.
Thank you. Have fun.
Oh, really?
Have fun. It is wonderful to be back again in this beautiful state of South Carolina. I live in Georgia. And I'm a real southerner. You can hear my accent. Somebody came up to me and says, "You are not from here. Are you one of those Yankees?" And as I know, I'm a true southerner. I am from the southwest part of Norway. So I just want to first, before we do anything, I just want to show you a picture of my family, because that's what we're all about, is about being family. On this picture, you see me together with my beautiful wife, Jennifer. She is a Cherokee Indian that is married to a Viking. You can imagine then you can start to see. And then some of the byproduct of that intimacy that we have with God and one another, you can see Courtney, Catherine, and Lila, and Leif Emmanuel. Three of them are born in Norway, and my son was born here in the States. And then we have my son-in-law, Rayvon. So I just want you to see this, Viking, Cherokee, 4 children. And then we got an African-American son-in-law. So hopefully in the future, we're going to have chocolate grandbabies. So just pray for us. Before we start and share, I just wanted to take you into Pakistan, because this is part of the video that we have a lot of video, but we have to shorten it this time. But I want you to see, because as a Norwegian Baptist pastor, to make the story short, I had an encounter June 6, 1995. I carry the picture with me in my bag everywhere I go, because some accidentally, the newspaper came there to make a mockery of the meeting. This is kind of more secular type of Norway. And the only picture that was taken from the meeting is when Randy Clark lays hands on me, and I'm this Baptist pastor. You couldn't even hide any longer that you're being touched by God, because it's in the newspaper. So I was kind of hiding in the closet, in a sense of, wow, I'm messing around with the Holy Spirit, but I couldn't tell a whole lot of people. And then in the next moment, I was in a newspaper, and it is just explosive. So I'm telling you that story because here I am. I'm a big, big dreamer. My big dream was to be able to see our Baptist church being the fastest growing Baptist church in Norway. And my next dream was to see our church going from 185 to 200. I know it's a very, very big dream. But then we had 2 funerals. And I'm like, then we have to go out and witness more. To reach my goal, we just kind of people, we need to go out and reach more. So I'm saying that, and then here I'm lined up just in an ordinary meeting, small group of us, my desperation level was greater than my fear level. So here you are, a young Baptist pastor, standing in a line, and Randy Clark just says, "Touch him, bless him, fill him." Came to me and he says, "You are a bulldozer." And I'm thinking, no, I'm a Baptist pastor. And In the next moment, I said, you're going to go into the darkest places in the world where the gospel has never been before, and you're going to make a way where there is no way. And this big light is following after you, and it goes into those areas. But then I see thousands of people are just following after you. And then you can imagine here, just where I was at in life, in the next moment, the power of God hit me. And sometimes one touch from God changes everything. One encounter with the presence of God changes everything about your life. And the next moment, for 2.5 hours, I felt the fire and I felt the power. I remember the Methodist, he criticized me for 2.5 hours. I was electrocuted, and for a week I could feel it. It's like when you've been wired for 110 and they plug you into 220. So this Norwegian body just couldn't handle this thing. And the Methodist, he was saying, why do you shake so much? I mean, I said, you take a nail, put it into the socket. If you don't shake, you judge me. I'm making that story because 17 years later in Pakistan, that's when you see this meeting. At that moment, we had been to over 80 countries, was all over the world. The Muslims radically, they burned down 200 Christian homes, 80 businesses. We watched it on television. And I just sensed this thing that, Father, just give me a love, not just for the victims, because we wanted to go and help the victims, but also give me the love for the one that victimized them. Because you only have authority over what you love. So don't pray for Greenville if you don't love Greenville. I'm here because I love Greenville. So in the middle of this incredible thing that was taking place, I just knew that I had to receive Papa's heart for those people. When you see the terrorist Saul, I want you to see the Apostle Paul. When you treat people, don't treat them based upon their history, but their destiny. And there is a destiny over each one of their life. So part of my assignment was to going into this place, meeting with some of those radical Muslim leaders, and you will see it, and the top Muslim leaders, bring them together, and let's stop this persecution. But also I sense that it's going to cost the enemy, not the people, but it's going to cost the devil because what he did to our Christian family. So what we did is we rented a big cricket stadium, and I told all over the area, I said, come to this meeting. 50,000 posters we told, come to this meeting because Jesus is going to show up. And I thought, God, that's not going to be a good idea, because if Jesus shows up, I get killed. But if he don't show up, I get killed. And I learned in leadership, you go for win-win situation. This looked like a lose-lose situation. So this is what we did. We followed just what Papa said we were going to do, rented a cricket stadium through some supernatural ways. Within 3 days, you would start to see a few people, and then the explosion of miracles started to take place. Blind eyes were seeing, deaf ears was open, the lame people were walking, and the rumors started to spread around that he is a good, good father. And then they also knew that they were being loved. This was not just a song of house fires. This was really a house fire. And it started to spread around, and then the rumors, and you will see in the end, by the third day, 87,000 people are standing, and they are surrendering to Jesus as a king. So watch. Congratulations. You're born for such a time as this. I stood, and while you were worshiping, I just took and I sneaked and I started to look at you. And I was just looking at the way that you were worshiping. One of the things I do, I always trust people that worship. Because the one that they are beholding is the one they're becoming. And I know what they become, they always will release. I was watching you while you were worshiping. And then Papa just says, Leif, he says, I want you to look at my sons and daughters. And the way that he was looking at you, and then he said something that touched my heart. He says, there's enough people in this room to bring a tipping point to America. Sure. There's enough of Christ within you, the hope of glory in each one of you, to be able to change the environment. And I think that part of the reason I'm showing this video is so you can just see that in the middle of the radicals and the terrorism, just an ordinary little Norwegian boy with a big papa. They're suddenly doing what the Father is doing and seeing what the Father is seeing. And that was part of my assignment. I had to shift my glasses to be able to see them the way the Papa God was seeing them. But before I can see the world the way it is, I have to see the world. Because you see the world based upon the glasses you have on. And some of us are not even aware that if we don't have sunglasses, S-O-N glasses, you're not going to be able to see into the bright future. Because you're going to be distracted by what the devil is doing if you don't see what God is doing. And if you do not capture what Papa God is up to, what he's doing, even in America, it's going to be very difficult for you because, as it's saying, as we're moving into the future is so bright because there is a new reformation coming. The first reformation restored Jesus. The second reformation restored the Holy Spirit. But this reformation is restoring the Father. And when the family is being restored, we're going to see the curse and the land will be broken. And all Islam is an orphan spirit. God cannot be a father. He cannot have a son. It is that orphan spirit and it is crying. Creation is moaning and groaning right now for the manifestations of the sons and daughters of God. We are the sons. We are the daughters. But you're not going to be able to know who you are until you know who your papa is. So when you're looking up and you start to see him as your loving father, then in the next moment you're going to look in the mirror and you can start to see you the way that you see the way that your papa sees you. And when you do not just believe in God, but realize that God believes in you. And Jesus didn't die on the cross to make you valuable. He didn't die on the cross just to make you valuable. He died on the cross because you are valuable. And if you do not know how valuable, look at what Jesus paid in regard to purchasing you. He saw something of very of high value. So my assignment, even as I'm coming in here, is a little bit different because I'm feeling the personality of this service and I'm just sensing all these amazing things that has God in doing. Let me give about 5 minutes of why I am here, how I ended up on this incredible journey. We left the voice of the apostle. We arrived in Atlanta and we drove here to Greenville and just sensing some of the things that the Holy Spirit is doing. I was trying to describe to Scotty, but one of the key leaders asked me, where are you going? And I said, I'm going to go to a place called Bridgeway. And he said, what is Bridgeway? Well, it's like the Bethel on the East Coast. And I'm saying that in regard, I've spent 15 years in relationship with Bethel on the East Coast. And so I didn't know, but that was the first time when we came here, and I started to sense that. Not that you're going to be that, you're going to be you. So bless you to be you. Be an original. But what I'm saying it is some of that prototype, some of the same DNA. And the excitement for me is the same because I've traveled all over the world. Right now, we have 100 nations open up for us. We can go into Syria and to change the environment. We can stop the peace, what's going on. The tension between Iran and Saudi Arabia, the tension you're seeing in the horrific refugee crisis with 2 million, all of those different crises, all I need is one son and a daughter. Give me a Daniel. Give me a Joseph. Give me an Esther. Give me a Nehemiah. Give me somebody here, a son and a daughter that is full of love and full of power and full of wisdom. I have some people that have power, but they don't have love. And people have love, but they don't have power. And then I have people that have wisdom, but they don't have power and love. But these are ordinary sons and daughters that are full of love. How you are rooted and grounded in love. And you know how high and how deep and how wide and how long that love. And then the fullness of God can dwell in you. And you can ask exceedingly abundantly more than you can think and ask. That comes from their very place. I don't know if you realize, but I'm excited. I'm a Norwegian that is excited. That's a creative miracle. When you get to know me a little bit better, you will see it. It's not an easy road. What you saw there, broken neck, broken back, the body cast, the tumor, to see the price. So if you had looked close at this Norwegian body, there's scars all over. 11 years on opiates just because of pain. Been through some of that. So I'm saying that it's not like, wow, we just decided to dream one day and it happened. No, it was a long journey, and the journey looks like this. But if you take the bottoms of this, it becomes a crown. So I love wilderness because something is happening. And this is what's taking place where many of us, we start to get rooted and grounded in love. So when the roots go deep, then suddenly becomes a tree of love. Then it becomes fruit and love. And then you become fruitful. And then when you get squeezed, what's in you come out. Baba. Love, joy, peace is just flowing out of your life. And the fruit of spirit becomes your weapon of warfare. So every time there is fear, love comes out and love casts out fear. So I'm saying that in regard to my journey in here. And then I didn't realize at the time when I met Pastor Chad and Wendy, when I met them, there's something happened in the spirit back then. I realized in my heart, even as I say, it was a unique meeting because I was speaking in a larger church at the time. And I just kind of came as a visitor. But still, there was something in my spirit. And then for another 4 years, let me see here. It was not the Holy Spirit, it was just me. So in the next journey then, and for the next season, for the next 4 years, I didn't know anything that has happened with you. And then God started to do, let me see here. This is Scotty Wilson. He is my personal assistant. Can you give Scotty a good hand? Isn't he amazing? So on this journey together, it took 4 years, and then I started to hear around the country of different people. They came up and they said, hey, have you heard about Chad and Wendy and the Bridgeway family? God is doing something. Somebody else started this. And I go somewhere else. Have you heard? And before you know, I was like, and finally I started to tune into it. And last year's at the Voice of the Apostle in Nashville, something unique happened because we're just showing up and I didn't even know. And in the next moment I felt this wind and it's like, what happens here? And I knew the presence of God hit and I realized the Spirit also hit him. There's a lot of people around. And I met Chad and I knew this is a supernatural. This is a sign to make me wonder. Signs and wonders. We always need to, when you see signs and wonders, always find out what you're supposed to wonder about. So I knew there was something there, and then I started this journey. God, what are you doing? There's something you are seeing here that heaven is attracted to it. So I'm just trying to go on a journey. Say, Papa, what are you up to here? And that started my journey. And one day at home, and I'm just giving you a short version, I'm sitting there and say, you're supposed to go on. Invest some time, spend some time, and find out what I'm doing and what I'm up to. And I realized it because my journey, as I'm saying, we saw open heavens. We saw revival. I was in the middle of revival. It was happening in countries all over the world. But in the middle of it, my sadness was after the signs, wonders, and miracles, what happens? We didn't have a family culture that could host heaven. We had visitation, but we didn't have habitation. And the other problem was we knew how to get people to heaven, but we didn't know how to bring heaven to people. We gave people a robe, but it didn't have a ring. So somehow, in a sense, that they didn't have the ring of sonship. They didn't have the ring of identity. They didn't have a ring to represent the Father here on earth. So in the next meeting, they needed another creative miracle. And the next year, I came back. So I went through this crisis 10 years ago where I tell them I was burned out because I'm traveling all over because there were so many orphans, they wanted to buy oil because I didn't know how to have oil of intimacy with a lover. And it just broke my heart. But I got burned out by mainly because everybody wanted your oil. And through my burnout season, I was together with Bill Johnson and Randy Clark in Minnesota where we're doing this healing school. Two poor Filipinos came. And he said, could you pray for us? And prayed for them, and oil came out of their hands. It's Paul and Almira. And these two poor Filipinos, again, I knew that this is something God is doing. In the next moment, I want you to capture this. In the next moment, they said, can you be our spiritual father? And I was thinking, I'm just learning to be a son. Because I'm in focus. I had an apostleship and leadership, many big ships. And I had sonship, but all my ship got shipwrecked. And the only one that survived was a tiny little boat called sonship. And there the dove rested. A son with a dove, a daughter with a dove. I'm putting this together. So this started my journey, and there's two things. So you have the revival that was going all over the world, but there was no family to sustain it. Now what I didn't know, I didn't have enough wisdom. I wish I had, but I didn't have enough wisdom. So here I was invited. That would be like the Super Bowl of who is whom in Christianity to speak at this event for 5,000 top leaders. And I was asking the Holy Spirit, I want you to say no. And I'm like, it must be the devil. But again, I was at the original Starbucks in Seattle in this invitation, and I thought, I mean, this would be, and the Holy Spirit, I want you to say no. And it was very difficult when I had to tell them, no, I cannot come. And they offered me all these things that would just be, but the Holy Spirit say no. And later on, these two poor Filipinos that I gave a father's blessing calls me from the Philippines on Father's Day 2006. Say, Daddy Leif, we are your new son and daughter from the Philippines. And I'm like, I just prayed for somebody in a conference. And now somehow here they are calling me on Father's Day. And say, can you come to the Philippines? Because we have all these orphanages that we call churches. And the orphans are coming together. We've been fasting, we've been praying, we're doing all these things. But we don't have a father's blessing. And like what happened to us? Because at that moment something shifted in them. They became sons and daughters. And to make that story short, I flew across the world to the Philippines. The Holy Spirit says, you do not have time for big conferences, but you have time for family. And it's the best investment I've ever done. I traveled across the world, met with two poor Filipino. The next 4 days, I was just together with them. It was no conference. It was us just living life together. But as we were hanging out and I started to get to know them, what I didn't know that was about to change in my life, I started to father them, and they brought 400 of their leaders together, and it was in a meeting. That was the second time that I experienced just what I did when I connected with Chad at Voice of the Apostle. That wind came in again, but this time it knocked over the speakers. So no, again, it was that. So I'm just connecting these things. One of them was when the revival, that same thing happened. The other one was when family. And there was a baptism of love over 400 poor Filipino who were struggling, and they all had an encounter with Papa's love. They knew Jesus, they knew the Holy Spirit, but they didn't know the Father. They had signs, wonders, and miracles, creative miracles. They've been going for it. They've been going for revival, but they didn't have a family culture to sustain it. And something started in this journey, and this was 10 years now into this journey, where we have been going on a regular basis all over the world. I took him, that's who, the Filipino you saw up on the video. That poor Filipino, that's part of the reason here. So I'm seeing this connecting. I'm in the meeting, 400 Filipino. All I did was three basic things, and it's connected what God is doing here. Identity, say identity. All of them got their identity back, to see them the way Papa God was seeing them. Who were you before the foundation of the world? I knew you. Who were you before you were in your mother's womb? I knew you. There's something in you, something you need. So when I looked at the 400 different people, Papa says, I want you to see him the way I see him. I want you to think about him the way I think about him. Feel about him the way I feel about him. But I want you to release, because in each one of them, there's potential to change the world. It didn't look like that in a natural. Nobody would believe in these people. But the Father says, just love on them like I love on them. Just receive it from him and give what I give them. Just represent me to them. And this journey that started, we have 400 Filipinos. They got their identity back. Poor. But now, not any longer. Identity. Second of all, say dignity. They all got their value back. Say value. Both religion and sin had devalued them. But certainly now they got their value. They started to see how valuable each one of us are. And the third one was dreams. Say dreams. They started to dream with God. One can do 1,000. What could two do? What could 400 do? I didn't realize, like David in his cave. I just came out of my cave. God gave me 400 people. So from a giant slayer, God raised up a culture of giant slayers. And these poor Filipinos, they're going into the nations, in 12 nations, just from that family. We have other families, but just from that family, there's revival fire. And it's burning brightly, but without burning out. Because they're burning oil of intimacy with their lover. So I'm saying that's been part of my journey. So I've had two times. One was when the revival, this wind came in. Then when the family, and then when a chat outside at Voice of the Apostle last year, the same wind came in. And then I started to figure, oh, revival, family. It's the only time in my life I've experienced this. And then I realized what Papa's doing. He's bringing those two together here. If you capture that, it can lead to joy. So be careful. And if it captures you, wow, it can lead to dancing, so be careful. And maybe the joy of the Lord will be your strength. Yes. Come on. So Paul, I want to just very simply put a little framework together for you because I want you to capture this. It's who you are. It's what you're carrying. There's four questions. Who are you? Individual, family, church. Who are you? It's all about this identity. Who is Bridgeway as a family? See that from heaven's view. Who are you individually? Who are you? What is your uniqueness? What is your special sauce? Why are people driving 2 hours to come here? Who is this family of families? Who are you? Second question is, where are you in your relationship to Him and people? Where are you? Have all to do with intimacy. Third question that is going to be clear in this season for this family. It is not just who you are as a family, who you are individually, where you are, but what do you have? What is available? What is God sending you? What is Papa God placing? Because if I had a time with each one of you, if you told me, you spend 1 hour and saying, here is the area the enemy has attacked me, I can tell you what your destiny is. Because when the serpent has bitten you is where you have the greatest authority. God believes in you. Heaven is attracted to you. There's a world changer and a history maker in you. And the biggest thing is for you to become you. I bless you to be you. Be an original. Copies are cheap. And I'm sensing this with Papa. Say identity. Say intimacy. Say inheritance. There's this incredible heavenly account. It's not just what you have. What I have in my account, in 22 nations right now, there's other family connected to you. And it is yours. It belongs to the family of families. And it's just an overwhelming feeling. And I could spend hours here just telling you the story about what God is doing there. I'm just so overwhelmed by His goodness and His kindness and His love. I'm just excited that we get to be part of the greatest move that the world has ever seen. I don't want to go back to Acts 2. I love what happened in Azusa Street. I mean, I don't want to go back to anything because the best, the greatest work of the Holy Spirit, and congratulations, you young people, you get to be part of something. It is just so amazing, and I'm about to prove it to you. So I want you to capture this, that this identity, the dignity, inheritance. So, excuse me, say identity, intimacy, inheritance, and destiny. That's the four things that is going to be very clear for all of you. This is who we are. And the clarity speak out who you are individually, but also this family. This is who Bridgeway family is. Where are you in the attraction to heaven and all these things that's taking place? What do you have? What is available? What is your individual special sauce? Bring it to the family table. If there's 2,000 people here, it should be illegal for you without having access to 1,999 other accounts. That's when you start to see it as a family. Because this is a kingdom family and heaven on earth is a family business. And the last one is destiny. Say destiny. What are you called to do? But it comes from a place of identity. From there's intimacy with God, with one another. Whoa, into me see. Intimacy. With Papa, with you. And then I realizing they have something I don't have. You have something here, Bridgeway. There's a uniqueness what God is about to develop here that Reading needs that. But you need also what they have. And then there's other places, 12 places in the country that God is doing this, sovereignly speaking, right now. He's setting up, but He's just setting up some prototype. So when people are starting to look, you cannot go to one place and get it all. But you go to one place and they will just, it's not like they need to run all over, but it's just they honor one another. And they are in a covenant relationship with one another. There is no control. Are you hearing me? There's no control. The Holy Spirit is going to be in control in such a way. And he's taking over. The first Reformation restored Jesus to the world. And it started a move of God's Spirit to change. I want you to hear that. Revival changes lives and changes churches, changes community. But Reformation transforms culture. And you have to have a culture to change culture. And the culture of heaven is being established here on earth. And it is a family culture. And to do that, you need the Father, Son, and Spirit. And I'm putting this together because I want you to capture just a... My thing is I take these 8 hours and I put it together 45 minutes. And it's just so difficult because I have so much stuff going in regard to what God is doing here. But I want you to... I'm trying to give you a visual so you will not forget it. I want you to look up on this screen for a moment and just show me how much time I have so I can be... If you look at this, the verse of 45 minutes... And it's just so difficult because I have so much stuff going in regard to what God is doing here. But I want you to, I'm trying to give you a visual so you will not forget it. I want you to look up on this screen for a moment and just show me how much time I have so I can be. If you look at this, the verse of Reformation of Grace, it was like fishing in the river, 1517. This Reformation actually swept across the world. How many of you are excited that you have education? Just wave. How many of you are excited that you are saved by grace? Wave. That you don't have to work for it. Are you excited about that? So there was this incredible river, and it started to spread, and the Renaissance and the creativity, a lot of that came from that. The education institution came because there was a Reformation. It changed the culture. Before that, you had to go to a priest to go to Papa. But now, justification by faith and grace alone. What it did is restore you back to Papa. Then you had access to the Bible for you to be able to have the Word of God yourself. You didn't have to go to somebody else. So let's treasure the Word of God. Somebody paid so that you and I have access to, wow, revelation every single day. So we honor, say honor. We honor the first Reformation. We honor Martin Luther. We honor who he is and what he carried and his part in church history, what he brought to a bigger picture as part of this kingdom family table. But there is more, say there is more. We honor the first Reformation, but not everything was being restored. Pretty much what happened is they were orphans. Martin Luther had major father issues. So it's not putting any blame, but Martin Luther in this thing is what happened. The Catholics in over 1,500 years, they didn't have many divorces. The Protestants right now, 14,000 denominations. In America, 486,000 churches that are more like orphanages. And if you don't agree with me, we get divorced and we start another orphanage. And actually what's in the center of this whole thing is self. Give me, touch me, bless me, fill me, 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 me. There is none like me. No, that's not the song, it is. There is none like you. Somebody came up and said, well, I didn't like worship. I said, the worship was not for you, it was for him. But then 1906 is moving in because God is about to say, wow, you've had the Word now. Let me give you the Spirit. Because if you overemphasize the Word, you dry up. That's what was happening. But now when you bring the Spirit together, you grow up. And if not, if you have the Spirit without the Word, you blow up. So God is giving a remarriage between the Word and Spirit that releases the power. What was the core value in the first Reformation? If you did an event here, who would you want to have? The teachers. And even pastors to take care of you. Second Reformation, who did you want? The anointed, the gifting, the power, all these people that could do the stuff. So what we did is we brought in prophets that could prophesy over us. We brought people with gift of healings that could pray for the sick, and etc. So there was a season for that, and I honor the second Reformation. Anointing, giftings, titles, power, with those different waves, started in 06. The Holy Spirit started to be poured out. Just wave to me for a second. I want you to see here. I talked to the top missiologist in the world 2 weeks ago. We sat together, and he says, Leif, did you know by 2030, that's only in a few years, 75% of all the believers in the world will be Spirit-filled. It's moving so fast. So the tribe you're part of is actually in the future the new majority. The Spirit is sweeping. So you have the Word and the Spirit. But there's nothing wrong. There's just something that is not right. I want you to capture this for a few moments. So I want you to see, because this is where you are at. And this is where you're at in time. Then what we're seeing now, we had, oh, it's so beautiful, the Father's blessing in Toronto, January 94, on Father's Day in Pensacola. Yep. It was on Father's Day, there was a new revival. And you see all these things that started to stir up in the spirit in the middle of it, but then we started going into an inlet of transition. The wall was going in, the shaking is beginning. Have you? How many of you know there's a lot of shaking going on in the wall? And in the middle of all this shaking, God is about to do something else. It's not as though things is bad. It's actually looking very good if you capture this. So now we are about 8-9 months pregnant, and there's about to be birth of another reformation. And the next reformation is restoring the Father. And when the Father is being restored, Father, Son, Spirit is coming into an alignment. The curse in the land would be broken. Poverty. I don't know if this excites you. But you're right in the middle of it. This is who you are. This is what you are about. This is Bridgeway family. This is what you're supposed to be prototype. How does the next reformation look like? The Agape Reformation. The first was grace. The second was power. We don't throw out those things. We build on it. We honor it. Are you seeing it? It's like we're not throwing out grace because we have power. We don't throw our power now. What we do is we build on it, but then the next one is going to be the Agape Reformation. The world is about to see that we are His disciples because we love one another. So what Papa is doing now, and this is, the first one was a baptism of water, the first Reformation. The second is a picture of the baptism of the Spirit. The next one is the baptism of love. Are you capturing it? What does baptism of love do? You get immersed in the Father's love, and you're being set free from fear. And you're stepping into an identity. And then the Christ in you that is going to be the hope of glory will be revealed. You're living from love, not towards love. You have an A+ before you take the exam. You're living from pleasure, not pressure. You're suddenly coming in, and I just want you to see, if you're part of the first two Reformation, if you came to the service, you will see what you can get. But when you're getting into the next Reformation, you will come in on Sunday morning and say, what can I give? Yes. Yes. It's a totally different way of living. Love, intimacy, light, community, relationship, rest. It's called the hard work of rest. It's family. When one gets healed, all of us are celebrating. One is hurt, everybody is hurting. And the immune system of the body of Christ is going to be so amazing. Whoa! That sickness and disease, I've seen it 3 times. Everybody gets healed just because of the unity of the body starts to operate like a family. And it's an impossibility for you to sit by somebody else without even recognizing the life flowing into you. But that's when you know who you are, and then you start to add value to everybody else around you because you're valuable. You don't need to get something to get value. No, you have value. The scripture verse that came to me, and I'm going to land with this on this service, was the Matthew 16, and I'm just putting in a simple way. This is the kingdom of God. Which one is this? Let's say that. This is the kingdom of God. Which one is this? This is the kingdom of self. Say self. Self. This is the kingdom of the world. Say world. In the world, 7.4 billion people lives in the world. Everybody lived a life from one of these three chairs. If you're in chair number one, you are saved. Say the word saved. Saved. Chair two, you are saved. Say the word saved. Chair three, you are lost. Say the word lost. If you're living in chair number one, the supernatural is what's natural. Let me say that one more time. If you are living your life here in this chair, the supernatural is what is natural. If you are a chair number one believer, you will hear His voice. You're seeing His face. You're feeling His love. You're experiencing His presence, and you're abiding in your Father's pleasure. He's already well pleased with you. The lifestyle here, wherever you go, you represent your Father. When they see you, they see Papa. You're living with a sonship. You're looking like Him, and you're loving like Him. What would it look like in your life? Wow, if Jesus just clothed Himself in your body and just lived His life through you, how would it be at University of Georgia? What would that look like when you're going into the classroom? What environment would change because of the environment that you're carrying? I'm not talking about this is something we're hoping for. This is something we're seeing. But we just have to be aware there is another chair. Say this chair. It's chair two. Chair You're saved. Say saved. You're going to heaven, but you don't know how to get heaven to you. In this chair, you're being influenced by this wall because you don't know how to influence the wall. When you're in this chair, it's not that Papa doesn't speak. It is only when he speaks, it has to filter its way through your emotion, will, mind to touch your spirit. Here you're living from fear. Here you're living from love. Everything in chair two is about doing, because here I do, say I do. Then I have, say I have. Then I become. So you're getting your identity based upon what you do or do not do. And you get totally focused about yourself. Here, my focus is what Jesus has done. And all that I have is yours. Here is, say, I am. Because I am, I have. Say, I have. And because of what I have, I do. Can you see the difference? It is not what you do that makes you who you are. It is who you are that makes you do what you do. I have to land this. It's a nice little 8 hours, but the only little thing from Matthew that I want you to capture. So Jesus is asking. Jesus is in chair one. So if you're looking at the world, 1.6 billion Muslims. You're looking at what's happening with the Hindus, the Buddhists, the Middle East, but also America. How do you see America? How do you see what's going on? Oh, election coming up. If you're from chair number two, fear. What does fear people do? Oh, look what's going on here. So you're talking about the giant instead of speaking to the giant. So from this chair, when you're looking there, it's like you're seeing how big the giant is. When you're looking here, you see how big Papa is. The one that rules and reigns the universe is my Papa. Look at America. But what you're seeing, what's going on in America, is all these orphans are trying to figure out, fighting with one another. Yeah. And the only solution to that is family. Yes. And the next revival in America is a family revival. Congratulations. Yes. If I have one of you, I can change the world. I change the classroom, change the business. From this place. So here's the question. Who do, chair number three, who does the world say that I am? That was Jesus asking, Matthew 16. Who do they say? And the disciple in chair two mentioned different things. They've been with Jesus for all this time. Finally, Simon here gets the question. Okay, Simon, now let me ask you, and I'm going to ask you the same question that Jesus asked. Who do you say that Jesus is? Who's Jesus to you? Because who Jesus will be to you is who he will be reflected through you. How you see him is how you see yourself. So the next question is, who do you, individual, who do you as a family, who do you say that I am? Simon is about to, but then he gets in chair number one. The Bible says he got the Father revelation. Just read it in Matthew 16. He got a Papa revelation. And this time he looks at Jesus the way Papa sees Jesus. And he says, you are Christ. What does Christ mean? Say the dove. That's the anointed one. That's what Christ means. You are the son of the living God. Say son. You are an anointed son. You are an anointed daughter. That's who you are. That's how I see you. When Simon captured this from the Father, that was the special sauce in the life of Jesus. Something changes and he says, you are Peter. You are rock. You're no longer going to be Simon up and down depending on the circumstance. You're going to be Peter. You're going to be a rock. Up on this rock, I will build my church. I'm going to build a bridge where I'm going to be up on this stone, up on this rock. I'm going to build a church that the gates of hell will not prevail against. The problem is not darkness, just a lack of light. The problem is not fear, just lack of love. Perfect love always casts out fear. Hey, take me in the darkest room. I was just at Sharia Law College with all the Sharia Law leaders. The only infidel ever in the history to be a lecturer. And the reason, and they call me the ambassador of love. I'm saying that 400 of them, and here are you. But isn't the light in me greater than the darkness in them? We don't have that. Wow, so let me get just an upgrade in his light, and he is the light. He's my joy. He's my peace. He's my presence. He's my power. He's my authority. He is. He is. I want you to say, I am. That's what he calls you. He says, I am. When you capture that, he says, I am. You say, you are. Say, you are. Greenville would say, he is. I am your healer. Be healed. I am your peace. I am your joy. I am your strength. I am your power. I'm your strength. Everything you have, he says, I am. And when you capture that, you say, you are. You're my healer. You're my strength. You're my power. You're my abundance. You are. And Greenville started in a newspaper, and the goodness revolution was on. He is a healer. He is a good God. He is. And the atmosphere starts to change. And I'm landing this, capture this. So upon this stone, do you know what the word stone in Hebrew is? It is Eb. Say Eb. And say Ben. The word Eb comes from Ab. Ab and Ben. Capture this. Upon this rock, say rock. The stone. I'm going to build a church that the gates of hell will not prevail against. Eb means father. Ben means son. Who do you say I am? An anointed son. Upon this rock, I'm going to build a church. The gates of hell can never prevail against it. But here's the second. Then I'm going to, here at Bridge, will give you the keys of the kingdom. So from chair number one, if there's injustice there, you lose justice. If there's sadness there, you lose joy. If there's bondage there, you lose freedom. The supernatural is going to be the natural. Ordinary sons and daughters. Say Ab. Say Ben. Father, son. On this rock, he will build a church. Not we building your church. He will build his church upon that identity. Are you getting it? Let's stand to our feet. I know you got a crash course here. Is that okay? How many here would like to be in chair number one? The super glue to chair number one is the baptism of love. Everything in chair number two is orphan thinking, is an orphan spirit. And we're going to release the parents in less than 1 minute, but I want us just, since we have the opportunity, this world here, this agape reformation, this tsunami wave of a love, and it's the Father's love is about to be swept across the nation. But he's looking for a kingdom family, chair one. And they're going to come. The harvest is so ripe right now. It is so ripe that it's just, we cannot even handle it. But he's just looking for family. Who will take care of them? Who will make the orphan sons and daughters? Bring them home into a family. And this is not just a family. All you are is like a franchise. You're a prototype. You're becoming a family. So what you become now will be reproduced. And you're going to get the authority over what you become. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
Is it getting you?
Yeah.
He's a good, good father. That's who he is. And you are loved by him. That's who you are. And wow. Just rest in it. Father, I just thank you so much for my family here. I thank you that bridge where you say kingdom family. I thank you for this family of families. I just ask even at this very moment, anyone that are been in chair number two, had a super glue, don't know even how to get out of it. They're tired. He says, come to me, all of you are weary, because the enemy is trying to wear us out. He says, come to me, come home. I'm going to give you rest. My burden is easy and my yoke is light. Just come. So Father, I just release even over my whole family here. I thank you for the generation of blessing over this house. I thank you for, wow, a lot of the people that pay the price so that we can be here today, that are in heaven. They're among the large cloud of witnesses that is watching what's going on here, connected to us. I thank you for fathers and mothers and grandmas and grandma, for sons and daughters. I thank you for all the generation coming together. And I thank you, Father, even at this very moment on something is shifting today, the clarity of you're going to build a church here that the gates of hell will not prevail against. And it's going to be an environment that is changing the environment. So I bless, listen, I bless the rest of your life. Get a double of that. I bless the rest of your life. I bless the rest of your family. I bless the rest of your finances. Come to chair number one, there is rest. And in rest you find fullness. I release it over to the pastor and he will bring the prayer team. And I will hang around, but we just want to take care of the children.
I'm going to ask our prayer service to come forward. And I want to honor Papa Leif today by getting prayer from other sons and daughters. I don't want anyone in this house to come to Leif for prayer today. One of our core values is getting people to the King's table and releasing them to do the works of the Father. In the old days, we brought in the great man or great woman of God, as he was talking about, and you would flock to that one person. Let's take our own brokenness and flock to other people who are walking in brokenness but moving towards the King's table identity. I want you to come get prayer this morning. Let me speak a blessing over us. The band's going to lead us, and I'm going to ask you to go pick your children up, please, if you can, right now from the children's ministry. In the name of Jesus Christ, may you build deep friendship with the Father. May chair number one be tattooed in the Spirit over you. Go in peace. God bless.